Is it challenging to get to Neptune, the farthest planet? Neptune is the farthest planet in the solar system. Since its discovery, only one spacecraft has reached this distant planet, making it the most unexplored planet of all. But why has it only been visited once? Is it because it's too far from Earth? Or is there something else preventing us from reaching Neptune? Let's find out. The first approach. The only spacecraft to reach Neptune was Voyager 2 in 1989. This was the first time the human race has placed a spaceship near this planet. Although 143 years has passed since its discovery, we knew very little about this planet. Neptune is the farthest of the four giant planets, is 30 times farther from the Sun than Earth, and takes 165 years to circle the Sun. Since its discovery, Neptune has not yet given a complete turn to the Sun. Its diameter is about four times larger than our planet's, but it lacks a solid surface where we can walk, just like all other gaseous planets. With the help of observations with telescopes from Earth, it was discovered that this planet has two moons. One of them is Triton, one of the most exciting objects in the solar system, since according to its light spectra, it could contain large amounts of liquid water. Although the telescopes of the time were very powerful, Neptune is so far away from Earth that it is impossible to observe its asteroid ring. Because of this, the data collected in a few hours by Voyager 2 gave us more information about Neptune than about a century and a half of astronomical observations from Earth. To scientists' surprise, Voyager 2 revealed a large dark spot on Neptune, similar to Jupiter's famous red spot. It is a gigantic hurricane with winds that exceeded 1,000 kilometers per hour, being the most violent in our solar system. On Earth, the Sun supplies the energy the winds produce. In the case of Neptune, the temperature at the top of the cloud cover is minus 210 degrees Celsius, so solar energy is insufficient to give rise to the winds observed by Voyager 2. Astronomers think that the planet follows a process of contraction from which it formed billions of years ago. This process would be the one that provides enough energy to generate these powerful winds. However, the general structure of the winds on Neptune has yet to be understood by scientists to date. Observations from Earth had provided evidence of rings around Neptune. However, this evidence was inconclusive as more than rings appeared to be pieces of rings, like thin arcs of matter swirling around Neptune. Voyager 2 helped us make this more expensive once and for all. And during its approach to Neptune in 1989, it found four complete rings, two of them thin and the other two wide. The thin rings are located near the orbit of two satellites thought to be responsible for their stability and therefore called shepherd moons. The two most extensive rings are formed by highly opaque material that reflects approximately 1/10,000th of the light that falls on them. This is why it would have been impossible to detect them from Earth. If we had not sent the Voyager probe 45 years ago, today we would not know of these rings of asteroids around Neptune. The reason why Neptune's rings are so opaque is that they contain a large amount of dust, which can only be explained if, in the vicinity of Neptune, there is a greater abundance of meteorites than in the innermost areas of the solar system. For more than a century, only one moon of Neptune called Triton was known. In 1949, Gerard Kuiper discovered a second satellite named Nereid, which rotates far from the planet. As happened in the previous encounters of the Voyager spacecraft with other planets, Neptune had more hidden satellites that were not visible from Earth. Voyager 2 discovered six new moons, including Despoina and Galatea, the two shepherd moons mentioned above. It also found Proteus, the largest of the new moons discovered by Voyager, which has a surface completely covered with craters, the largest of which is almost half the size of Proteus. Despite these findings, Neptune's largest moon, Triton, the one known for more than a century, remains the most interesting. A difficult journey. Being the farthest planet in the solar system, it is logical that space agencies think twice before carrying out a mission to this planet. The Voyager 2 probe took more than a decade to reach the orbit of Neptune, and this was thanks to the fact that it had several gravitational assists with which it took the momentum and thus shortened the travel time. Without those gravitational assists, it would have likely taken at least five more years to reach Neptune. Can you imagine that? A 15-year mission to reach a planet brings challenges that are very difficult to overcome. Neptune is more than 4 billion kilometers from Earth. Even the sun's rays become scarce at this distance. Due to the absence of light, any spacecraft sent to this planet must necessarily use a nuclear power source, since the solar panels will not capture enough light. Mounting a nuclear battery on a spacecraft involves several engineering challenges. Still beyond those challenges, these batteries considerably increase the spacecraft's weight, eventually making it more expensive. In summary, the difficulties that would arise to reach Neptune are the same as those that arise to reach Uranus, which is much closer. Despite all the difficulties that may arise in reaching Neptune, this planet has exciting features that are attractive to astronomers. Thanks to this, there is currently a proposal by NASA to send a ship back to this planet. A unique climate. Neptune's meteorology is characterized by very dynamic storm systems, with winds reaching almost 600 meters per second or 2200 kilometers per hour, and almost reaching supersonic flow speeds. Although its composition is very similar, Neptune has a much more violent atmosphere than Uranus. Voyager 2 observed weather phenomena on Neptune during its flyby in 1989, but observed no comparable phenomena on Uranus during its flyby in 1986. In 2007, Neptune's upper troposphere of the South Pole was found to be about 10 Kelvin warmer than the rest of the planet, which averages about 73 Kelvin, or minus 200 degrees Celsius. The temperature difference is enough for methane, which freezes in the troposphere elsewhere, to escape into the stratosphere near the pole. This hotter region is due to the tilt of Neptune's axis, which has exposed the South Pole to the Sun during the last quarter of Neptune's year, equivalent to about 40 Earth years. As Neptune slowly moves towards the opposite side of the Sun, the South Pole will darken and the North Pole will brighten, causing the methane release to shift to the North Pole. Due to seasonal changes, Neptune's southern hemisphere cloud bands have been observed to increase in size. This trend was first seen in 1980 and is expected to last until 2020. The long orbital period makes the seasons on Neptune last 40 years. The jewel in the crown, Triton. In addition to the exotic weather, Neptune is something that Uranus does not have, and this is the main reason why NASA is planning a new mission to Neptune and not to Uranus, which is much closer than Neptune. We're talking about Triton. With a diameter of 2,707 kilometers, Triton is the largest satellite of Neptune and the seventh in the solar system, as well as being the only large moon that has a retrograde orbit, that is, an orbit whose direction is contrary to the rotation of the planet, something exceptional in a body of such size. Because of this retrograde orbit and its composition, similar to that of Pluto, astronomers consider Triton to have been an object captured from the Kuiper Belt by the gravitational pull of Neptune. Triton is composed of a crust of nitrogen frozen on top of a mantle of ice, which is believed to cover a solid core of rock and metal. It also has an average density of 2,061 grams per centimeter cubed, and according to observations of its chemical spectrum, it is composed of approximately 15 to 35% water in solid state, i.e., ice. This natural satellite is one of the few in the solar system known to be geologically active. Due to this activity, its surface is relatively young and reveals a complex geological history, from mysterious and intricate cryovolcanoes and tectonic terrains. After Voyager 2 passed through in 1989, enigmatic images revealed what appeared to be liquid nitrogen geysers emanating from its icy surface. This discovery left the scientific community astonished, since it completely changed the classical concept of volcanism, because until then, it was assumed that icy bodies should not be geologically active. Triton was the first exception to that rule. This natural satellite showed us that there must not necessarily be a rock fluid for geological activity. Still, it can also be nitrogen or water. Ice volcanoes. The fact that Triton has so few craters indicates that its surface is constantly renewed due to some geological processes. Valleys and ridges are in a complex pattern all over the surface, probably resulting from freeze-heating cycles and volcanoes. The Voyager 2 probe observed icy volcanoes, plumes, vertically spewing liquid nitrogen, dust, or methane compounds, coming from below the surface, in smoke reaching 8 kilometers high. Probably this volcanic activity is due to the ozone warming caused by the sun, and not like the heating of the volcanoes recorded on Io. Healy and Mahalani are the observed Tritonian cryovolcanoes, both named after water spirits from African mythologies. Triton is one of the 7 bodies in the solar system that possesses volcanic activity along with Earth, Io, Venus, Europa, Enceladus, and Titan. We could continue talking for hours about this fantastic satellite, but we need another video. If you want a video about Triton, the largest Neptune moon, let us know with a comment. Thanks to this satellite with enormous possibilities of hosting liquid water and perhaps even living beings, the OPAG, Outer Planets Assessment Group, has named Neptune a priority for space research, even above Uranus. OPAG wants to start developing a mission to Neptune before 2024 to take advantage of the 2028 to 2030 launch window to send a mission to Neptune. The probes to the ice giants must use Jupiter's gravitational assistance to reduce the duration of the trip, but Jupiter and Neptune are in the correct position every 12 years or so. With Jupiter's gravitational assistance, the probe would reach Neptune in the year 2043 approximately. However, to date, there still needs to be a clear proposal of which will be the ship in charge of revealing the mysteries of this unexplored planet. Will we soon see a new mission to explore Neptune? Let us know what you think in the comments of this video.